Day in and day out, you're using one of the biggest machines in the world and you may not even know it. It's in your home, it lines the streets, and it's powered by gigantic engines across the country. The biggest machine in the world isn't this, or this, or even this. It's the electrical power grid, or more specifically, the US power grid. In the United States alone, the grid contains enough high voltage wiring to wrap around the Earth six times over, and that's not including all the low voltage wiring running through our streets and into our homes. This entire system was built in a little over 100 years, and since then, we have become very accustomed to having electricity available to us at the flip of a switch. But before this machine existed, our only sources of light by night were lanterns and candles, and nearly all our daily chores needed to be done by hand. This giant machine started pretty small with the world's first central power station, built on Pearl Street, Manhattan in 1882. Thomas Edison, the ever-present American businessman, saw an opportunity to not only sell more of his light bulbs, but to sell the electricity to power them too. So he built an electric generator driven by a coal-powered steam engine to create electricity at a cost that would allow his light bulbs to compete with lanterns. The station contains six of these generators, each producing 100 kilowatts, enough to power 1,200 of Edison's light bulbs, allowing Edison to sell 7,200 light bulbs, which needed to be replaced regularly, as these light bulbs lasted about 1,200 hours. Even then, the project ran an operating loss for its first 2 years. Setting up this system was a bold business move. The machines, the conduits, and the 30 kilometers of wiring needed for it were expensive, at a cost of $300,000, or about $20 million in today's money. The expensive Lower Manhattan real estate didn't help either, but Edison's placement of the Pearl Street station was vital to the success of the idea, as it had the population density to make the project financially viable. But he also made one of his first customers the New York Times, who published a story about the historic event, reporting that the light was soft, mellow, and graceful to the eye, without a flicker to make the headache. This was all the marketing Edison needed, and demand for the system grew. But this pointed out one of the system's major flaws. It couldn't scale economically without installing more power stations nearby, because it generated a low voltage direct current. And to efficiently transfer power over long distance, we need to transform the low voltage to a higher voltage. The power loss equation states the power lost in transmission equals the current squared multiplied by the resistance of the wire. And so to reduce power loss, we really need to minimize the current. This equation describes the relationship between power transmitted and the voltage and current. The community demand fixes the amount of power required, and so to decrease the current, we need to increase the transmission voltage. Alternating current's main advantage over direct current isn't that it loses less power over long distance, but that it can be transformed from low voltage to high voltage much more efficiently than direct current. Thus, as demand for power grew across the nation, the famed argument between Edison's idea to have many smaller generators located near population centers and Nikola Tesla's idea of having one large efficient engine located far from population centers grew. Of course, we know who won, and today we have hundreds of gigantic power stations located far from population centers generating gigawatts of power. So what would a map of the current US electrical grid look like? Let's create a map showing the largest power plants across the US. In areas where rainfall is high, like Washington State on the west coast and Alabama in the south, there's a high volume of electricity generated with hydropower. Where wind speeds are highest in Central America, there is a growing number of wind turbines. And states that get the most sun, like California and Arizona, have the highest percentage of solar power. There are several high-powered nuclear power plants located in areas where water is plentiful, which is needed for the steam turbines and to cool their cores. Coal power plants tend to be close to coal mines, as it's a very heavy fuel. But the largest percentage of energy in the US is generated from natural gas, as it's the cleanest of the fossil fuels. Let's zoom in on one of these power plants to get an idea of how this energy is delivered to population centers. As I mentioned earlier, it's vital that electricity is transmitted at high voltage. So the first step as the electricity exits the power plant is to pass through a step-up transformer. The electricity is then delivered across these high voltage power lines that you see stretching across the country. These power lines feed into local step-down transformers for local distribution in neighborhoods and get stepped down again by these transformer drums on poles outside your house. The electricity you consume in your house is measured on a meter like this that reads the power running through the wire that enters your house. So let's say, after a long day's work, you come home and decide you want to watch the premiere episode of Game of Thrones. You plug in your viewing device of choice, and that meter starts to tick a little bit faster, along with millions of other meters across the nation. Suddenly, the biggest machine in the world just got a little bigger, and the engines powering it have to work harder to keep up with that demand. This is one of the huge disadvantages of the current power grid. During low demand hours, we have a number of always-on power plants called baseload plants. They are powered by reliable energy sources like coal and nuclear. These maintain the baseload requirements of the country. But what happens if one of these power stations fail? Suddenly, the system doesn't have enough energy to meet demand, and if we don't have the ability to meet it, power stations will begin rolling blackouts, where they cut the electricity to certain areas to prevent a larger blackout. One of the largest of these rolling blackouts to ever occur was the 2003 Northeastern blackout that left 50 million people without electricity. Modern countries will have many redundant power sources that can be brought online when power demand surges or power stations go down, and excellent communication between all parts of the grid to ensure problems can be fixed immediately. But as renewable sources like wind and solar become more popular, this micromanagement of the power grid is becoming even more difficult. We cannot command the weather to make these power sources work harder when needed, and the more likely scenario is that we have to shut down these power sources while they could be generating energy, because they are generating energy that is not needed, which can overload the system. It's unlikely that we will be able to rely on renewable energy without still having many baseload power plants running on natural gas, coal, or nuclear, unless we can create an efficient way of saving this energy during peak performance for later use when the demand is there. Currently, the largest energy storage method worldwide is hydroelectricity at about 80%. On some days of the year, Denmark generates so much energy from wind that they have enough to export to countries like Norway, who often use the advantage of their mountainous terrain to buy cheap excess power to pump water to the top of mountains. This water can then be released to power hydroelectric turbines when it's needed. Of course, this leads to some power loss, but it's better than shutting down the wind turbines while they're at peak performance. This issue is only going to grow as solar energy becomes more and more popular, which is why Tesla's Powerwall is such an integral part of making widespread home-installed solar power a reality. If we cannot store the excess energy generated by these panels during the day for use when there isn't sunlight, then we are still going to depend highly on those baseload power plants using fossil fuels or nuclear energy. As the price of manufacturing solar panels decreases, it's inevitable that all countries will begin to move away from the current model of the power grid. We are on the brink of a world-changing moment, and the largest machines in the world are going to change drastically for the better. Large fossil fuel power plants generating AC electricity are quickly becoming outdated and will be gradually decommissioned over the next couple of decades, and a new model for the power grid will rise in its place. We will be gradually moving towards Thomas Edison's early vision of having many local low-voltage power generators creating DC power, but with a modern twist. They will all be powered by nothing more than the energy we can draw from the ever-replenishing pool that nature has provided us.
Oh yeah, thanks for watching. So this week, I wanted to take you for a walk and tell you a story. And it's currently snowing in Galway, and this is an old ring fort. You know, those forts that kept cows safe in from the Vikings. It's near my house in Galway. So I wanted to tell you a story about when I was starting this channel. I was using a really crappy laptop. It was old. It was like 4 or 5 years old. I wasn't really capable of doing animations. Definitely wasn't capable of doing my animations. And it broke down like 3 times while I was using it. And I ended up losing a lot of files. And I couldn't afford to buy a new one, so I just kept on having to like reboot it and start it from scratch. Occasionally I had files saved to my cloud services, and that was okay. But it didn't do much for me when I had files saved locally, and that's what this week's sponsor is for. So this week is sponsored by Backblaze, and Backblaze are an incredible site. I've been using them for a little while now. And they're only $5 a month, which allows you to back up all your files automatically. And in the case, worst case scenario, when something actually does happen and you lose all the data on your computer, you can go back, download files individually, or you can download all of them at the same time. Or if your computer is just completely wrecked like mine was, you can get the option of downloading a hard drive instead. And if you don't want the hard drive, you can just send it back. So that's $5 a month, or you can use the link below, which is backblaze.com/engineering for a 15-day trial. Seems like a pretty good deal, right? I suggest you do it and it'll support the channel. Tell them I sent you. I'm just gonna show you some scenes from the beautiful west of Ireland. Jesus, fuck. Fucking cow shit.